Gogol was a Ukrainian-born Russian writer. Most people read Dostoevsky and Chekhov and Tolstoy and forget about this guy. His life and death were very mysterious. He couldn't write in flowery language, poetry and prose. He couldn't be the next Pushkin. His style is closer to how people actually spoke. Pushkin said, "I write prose far more incorrectly, but I speak still worse, nearly as bad as Gogol writes." Gogol's first impression of St. Petersburg wasn't the best. In one of his letters, he criticizes the bureaucracy, the multiculturalism, people's obsession with ranks. You will see this in his works too. Two of his biggest literary influences were Goethe and Hoffman, and he was a huge inspiration for writers like Bulgakov and Dostoevsky. There's a quote that says, "We all came out of Gogol's overcoat." Most people attribute it to Dostoevsky, but it actually belongs to Eugène de Voguer. If you want to read Gogol, here's where you can start. My first recommendation is The Overcoat. It's one of the most famous short stories depicting the little man. The protagonist is a copyist and his career is his entire identity. He loves his job, he loves letters, and every time he gets to one of his favorite letters, his entire face changes. Once he was given something more important than copying, he had to change some words from the first to the third person, and he couldn't do it. He's good with letters, not with words. He treats letters as something sacred. He loves the form rather than its meaning. To be fair, I think that his documents have no aesthetic value, so in a sense he doesn't have a choice. He's actually one of the luckiest characters in Gogol. He found his purpose in life and he's happy doing what he does. Our hero, Akaki Akakievich Bashmachkin, is a titular counselor. Okay, I know, this sentence gives us a lot to dissect, but let's be patient and start with the end. What the hell is a titular counselor? Okay, so in Imperial Russia, there was this official list of positions and ranks in the military, in court, and in the government. This list was called the Table of Ranks, and it's quite important if you want to understand most Russian classics. The rank of titular counselor conferred personal nobility and it was class 9 out of 14, so not bad at all. The thing is, the next rank, that of collegiate assessor, made it hereditary, so Akaki Akakievich was one step away from making his future descendants noble. Everyone who had a rank had to be addressed properly. Your Excellency, Your High Excellency, and so on. Very important if you didn't want to offend anyone. Now, the ridiculous name. So, I guess most people know this, but just in case, his name is Akaki, and he's the son of Akaki. This is why he's Akaki Akakievich. This name makes the narrator feel awkward, so that's why he says that it was inevitable. All the other names suggested by his godfather were even worse. This name comes from ancient Greek and it means innocent and meek. And even baby Akaki cries when he hears it, when he is baptized, as though he foresaw that he was to be a titular counselor for the rest of his life. He's lonely, he's mistreated, and on top of that, he's ridiculed. It's so sad when decent, well-mannered men make fun of him and don't let him do his job, and he says, "Let me be. Why do you do this to me?" Trying to say, "I am your brother." He's so humble and small and human. The Overcoat is lyrical in some sense. It presents this guy who can't stand up for himself. He discovers that his coat is extremely worn down and will be unfit for the winter. He goes to his tailor and his tailor tells him that he will be unable to repair it. And when he tells him the price of the new coat, Akaki Akakievich decides to live frugally, to go hungry to save money for the overcoat. It becomes his new obsession. He trades his love for something immaterial, his letters, his resignation with his place in this world, for something heavy and dense, the overcoat, the promise of a new social status, which will supposedly give him a new identity. The story discusses the power that material things have over people, the things endorsed in our society. Just like Adam and Eve, Akaki Akakievich feels the need to cover himself. Well, to protect himself from the awful Russian winter, but also from people. Will he buy the overcoat? Will it change his life? Let's find out. The one-star reviews say that this story is dull and unnecessary, but usually they don't go into detail about it. At least it's 50 pages long, so it won't take too much of your time. If you like Battleby the Scrivener, if you like The Man in the Case by Chekhov, if you like The Station Master by Pushkin, if you like Franz Kafka, if you like the more sentimental passages from Dostoevsky, you will probably enjoy The Overcoat. My second recommendation is The Diary of a Madman. It's a tragicomedy about another titular counselor who is mistreated. He's not in love with his job, he doesn't copy things for fun like Akaki Akakievich. Instead, he writes in his diary. Paprishin, our protagonist, sees himself as a victim, tormented by the world around him. He likes to watch amusing plays because they make fun of the people he hates. He desperately wants to belong to the hereditary nobility, and he's in love with his director's daughter. One day, he sees her entering a shop. Her dog, Maggie, remains outside, and he hears how this dog, Maggie, talks to another dog, Fidel, and tells her that she wrote a letter to her, but apparently it hasn't arrived. Paprishin follows the second dog to see where she lives. And we will get to see the letters, don't worry. The fact that dogs can write shocks him even more than the fact that they can speak, but not because they are dogs, but because only noblemen can write, and the dogs don't belong to the nobility. In another note, he writes that someone made fun of him for courting the director's daughter, and that guy must be jealous, he concludes. He wants to talk to the dogs to find out more about the lady in question. The rest of the story is pure awesomeness if you like reading about madmen. The logic here is different from the conventional one, and reason doesn't apply to Paprishin's world. Traditionally, the story is interpreted as a reflection on the abnormal social organization, the ease with which the individual becomes defined by the rank. But it can also be seen as a realistic portrayal of someone's descent into madness. To say that the reader's idea of the narrator and his own self-perception do not coincide would be an understatement. Gogol did some research, he read books on psychiatry, and he does an amazing job describing the protagonist's mind. You will like this if you liked Bulgakov's satire and Chekhov's Word Number 6. It's really ahead of its time, and it's absolutely ridiculous in the best sense of the word. Another great choice would be The Portrait. A young artist buys a painting with his last money, and this portrait depicts an old man with a bronze-colored face and piercing eyes. Trying to capture every detail, the artist looks into his eyes and he feels these eyes gazing back into his own. The painting seems both lifelike and unfinished, and for some reason it's heavier than expected. The artist wonders why he bought it. At night, he dreams that this old man steps out of the frame with a sack of money, and in the morning, his landlord asks him for money, and they find a lot of it in the frame. What does the artist do with the money? He has two choices. One, to work on his craft, to devote himself to painting. His teacher saw a lot of potential in him. And two, to advertise in papers and to become a commercial portraitist. It's an allegorical fable with supernatural elements. It represents the fight between high ideals and personal gain. A compromising artist is a mediocre one, according to the writer. Most artists don't have the privilege to work for themselves. They have to change to please the client. It also discusses the compromises an artist has to make between the idea and the real thing being someone's face. Usually, the idea is more beautiful than the real thing. It lacks the comical elements, but it's an interesting reflection on art and temptation. And it's also a beautiful social commentary. If you like stories about art and artists, you'll probably like The Portrait. I think that this is the most European of his short stories. It has something in common with The Oval Portrait by Poe, The Unknown Masterpiece by Balzac, and The Picture of Dorian Gray, but it's also unique in some ways. Another story that would be great for the first time is The Nose. One day, a barber finds a nose in his bread. He recognizes it. It belongs to a collegiate assessor named Kovalov. Remember, collegiate assessor is one rank higher than Akaki Akakievich, and the madman is the first rank to receive hereditary nobility, the same rank as Dostoevsky's underground man. But Kovalov doesn't like to call himself a collegiate assessor. He likes to call himself a major because it sounds cooler. So the barber manages to get rid of the nose by throwing it into the river. Kovalov wakes up and wants to check out the pimple on his nose. Uh-oh, the nose is missing. At least he got rid of the pimple. He is very embarrassed that he has to go outside looking like this. He sees his nose and he seems to be a state counselor now. Again, the table of ranks, state counselor is rank 5, so 3 ranks higher than Kovalov himself. The nose goes to church to pray, reasonable, and Kovalov doesn't know how to approach him. He's so shy because the nose is higher in rank. Anyway, he asks the nose to come back, and the nose declares its independence. This story can have many interpretations. You can see it as a satire on the snobbery of the upper classes, or the nose could represent some other body part, and then this would be a story about masculinity and sexual dysfunction. I can't stop you from doing that. Kovalov is obsessed with his appearance and his social rank. What would be a better wake-up call than compromising both? He instantly becomes more self-aware. The part becomes more important than the whole. If in other romantic tales, someone can lose his shadow or his reflection, losing something so trivial adds more humor into the story. "How can I carry on without a nose?" said Kovalov. "Whatever you do, it couldn't look any worse, and God knows that's bad enough. How can I go around looking like a freak? I mix with nice people. I'm expected at 2 soirees today." The author writes in a letter, "If the censors will be offended that the nose goes to an Orthodox church, he could go to a Catholic one." Needless to say, he had an obsession with noses, with nose puns, and he was conscious about his own one. The story is grotesque, implausible, and self-aware. It highlights the absurdity of human existence. Another amazing short story is called How the Two Ivans Quarreled. There are two distinguished gentlemen, Ivan Ivanich and Ivan Nikiforovich. They have been neighbors and friends for years. In this world, to call someone a goose is the most insulting thing imaginable. Anyway, two grown men fight for no good reason. And everyone is shocked because they were such good friends. The author uses unusual details to describe the characters, and he also does this in parallel. If one Ivan is tall, the other one is shorter. If one Ivan is thin, the other is thicker. If one of them is timid, the other is more outgoing. The author's irony gets to you when you find out that one of the Ivans is so loved by everyone in town because he has a nice house and because he knows the commissary of Poltava. And he's a good Christian because every Sunday he goes to church. Vulgarity becomes self-importance. Meanness becomes generosity. The author reveals the contradictions between appearance and essence. If you think that Russian classics are all doom and gloom, this short story will surprise you. I can't end this video without mentioning his most famous play, The Government Inspector. The mayor finds out that an inspector is coming to visit his district and that he will be traveling incognito. He and all the other officials have to get their affairs in order and to get rid of all the evidence of bribes. He asks the postmaster to open all the letters to see if they can find the inspector. Fortunately, the postmaster says that he always reads the letters. This town is a mess. Two squires say that they discovered who is this inspector. An official from St. Petersburg is staying at the inn. Again, people worshipping ranks. Every character represents some part of the administration. Court, police, healthcare, and so on. Many people were surprised that the play passed the censor board. The Tsar Nikolai I was famous for banning many works. The audience was divided. Some of them thought that it was a nice political satire, and the others that it was a defamation of the officials who are working for their benefit. The Tsar said, "What a play! We all took a hit, most of all me." And he didn't ban it. It must be that good. I didn't include here his works inspired by the Ukrainian folklore because I think that they might be too intimidating if this is your first experience with this author. Also, I didn't include Dead Souls because it's his most famous work and it doesn't need advertising. I hope that I convinced you to give this guy a try. He truly deserves it. If you read any of these books, I'd like to hear your thoughts in the comments. Thanks for watching. Bye!